response system activated.
We'll be right back.
remember when Rob and I first met was actually just in a, this guy that we knew in his house. He had a bit of a studio happening. And Rob and I were both working on solo careers.
Luke and I weren't friends before we, you know, started to working together. We just met and started working together. It was kind of like a business hookup. We were just interested in writing and, you know, furthering our own solo careers.
I had been in a band that had just broken up. Rob was just kind of getting started on his own career, and he was just doing some recording there, and I was waiting to start my session, and I was really digging what he was doing.
As things progressed, you know, we started hanging out, becoming really good friends, and it's like the perfect working relationship.
The stuff that we were writing just seemed to be a lot better than the stuff that we were writing on our own. Collectively, it was a lot stronger. So we just started getting really good feedback from people when we played them the demos. Like, we would both sing the harmonies when we started demoing these songs, and we just kept progressing from there.
We're really good friends, and we work really well together. And everything seems to balance out.
Love wins every time.
since we got together and started writing together, things have definitely picked up in terms of how things are progressing, in terms of where we want to be as artists.
When I first started, the first thing I ever did was writing songs, but I liked everything about the idea of becoming, you know,
being famous.
But there are certain things that people don't realize that are really challenging about it, that might not occur to certain people.
All in all, it's good. It's a good experience. You know, you get to meet a lot of new people that you probably wouldn't have met otherwise. And you know, bottom line, it all depends on how bright the spotlight is. When we first got released, you know, it wasn't that bad. You know, we could still walk around and stuff like that. But you know, now I can't even go shopping anymore. I can't go to the mall. Tried. It doesn't work anymore.
Just because of the nature of the industry, there's so much contact with people. It's really great to know that people are recognizing what you're doing. You can have fun sometimes too. You know, if you want to go to a club, sometimes it can be easier to get in. There's those kind of fringe benefits.
There's really no rhyme or reason to the way that we do things, like in terms of writing. A lot of times what will happen is one of us will have an idea and we'll, you know, bring it to the studio, do a little bit of sequencing on it, or show it to each other on the guitar or something, and it'll grow from there.
Rob and I will start songwriting like at the drop of a dime. Like there's been times when we've just been on the road driving and we'll finish an entire song between cities. A lot of times it's sound checks and stuff. We'll just start jamming. The band, him and I, we'll have some, he'll have an idea or I'll have an idea on the guitar or he'll sound on the piano.
Luke and I come from very different musical backgrounds in terms of the stuff that we listen to. I was into like R&B, hip hop, and you know, a lot of soul stuff like Stevie Wonder, you know, Aretha Franklin, The Temptations, that kind of stuff way back in the day. And he comes from more of like a Beatles, Cat Stevens, U2 side of things. We've both done a lot of songwriting on our own. The best stuff is the stuff that we've collaborated on. Bring different things to the mix, and in that respect, when we put it all together, it seems to make this interesting feel.
the second I close my eyes, the second I see your face. But the daydreams aren't good enough. Imagination can't take your place. And to say that I'm missing you is to tell only part of the truth. There's no way to deny that I'm dying inside. I've got nothing left to lose. There is only one emotion to feel, yeah. Cause there's only one emotion that's real. It's only natural. You should be in my arms. There's only one
emotion.
And I'm taking it day by day. And I'm pretending I'm doing okay. And I cry in the rain to hide the tears and the pain. Girl, please tell me we can start again.
Oh, baby,
there is only one emotion to feel. Cause there's only one emotion that's real.
It's only natural.
You should be in my arms. There's only one
emotion.
There's only one.
When I started writing songs, it's a very intimate thing. It's a very personal thing, and there can be a lot of insecurities about it at first. No one had ever heard anything I'd ever written. I remember, especially my youngest brother, because at the time he was just a young guy, like I don't know, 12, 13 years old, and I just drag him down the stairs. I'm like, I want you to listen to this, because they knew I was involved in music and stuff. So I'd be like, what do you think of this song I wrote? And he'd just sit there and he'd listen, it's not bad. Or, that sucks. And then every once in a while, that's pretty good, I like that. So it was very encouraging, and my whole family was like that.
Family is very important to me. When I first decided that I was, gonna do this as a career and pursue this, they thought I was kinda kind of crazy, you know, that they were thinking, go to school, get a real job, you know. Music is such a tough industry to make it in that, you know, you're probably making a big mistake, but it was just something that I really believed in, and now they're as supportive as any family could be. They come to all the events, they, you know, they tell all their friends about every time we're gonna be on TV and stuff like that, and, you know, my son's this, my son's that, you know. They're very, very supportive.
Sometimes Friday nights when I was younger, they'd invite kind of friends over, and we'd sit around the living room, and I'd play for them. You know, pull up my acoustic guitar, and they just loved it, and they were very encouraging. You know, and I think that kind of support from the beginning is really helpful.
Pretty much one day I was sitting around in the basement, just, you know, singing along to some record that my dad was playing. I don't remember what it was. I was like 4 years old, and since then, I guess my parents were. I guess it was just obvious to them that, you know, I should be doing something along those lines. It worked out pretty well. You know, I learned what I needed to know.
Oh!
get a lot of nice stuff from our fans. You know, we get teddy bears and, you know, flowers and letters and pictures and stuff. And
I got some socks just the other night from a fan. They were nice socks too. I was pretty happy.
They're for his birthday, actually, because she promised, you know, she would get him some socks for his birthday. And
but it's amazing how some fans are, how resourceful they can be.
Come on, go!
I've gotten calls from people at my house from across the country. Somehow they figured out like where I lived, my phone number, and someone was asking for tickets to a show we were doing here in Vancouver, calling me from here to Winnipeg.
If it was left just up to, you know, the old-fashioned way of, you know, the fan club sending a letter and that kind of thing, it would be really, really hard. But especially with the, you know, the website and, you know, the email communication, we have a good way of communicating with the fans. Obviously, from a performer's perspective, I'd prefer to have a large audience, because then, you know, that's the most number of people that you can reach at one time. But there's something to be said for having a small, you know, 100, maybe, you know, even smaller than that, 50 people in a room in front of you, because you can really, really connect with that kind of an audience.
Thank you. So you guys having fun or what?
This next song that we're going to play for you guys is actually a song that we wrote for a female singer, someone that was trying to get a career started in our hometown. But we made the mistake of actually playing it live in our own band one time, and ever since then it's been probably one of our favorite songs.
So we're going to do it instead. Here it is. It's called I Understand.
Talking to myself again. Lately I've been seeing less of you. What's a man to do?
Understand, oh baby, yeah. I understand.
Probably quite a few things that Rob does that drive me crazy. I don't want to get too into it right now, but
he knows I'll beat the crap.
Yeah.
Put it.
I went to pick him up, and I was like waiting half an hour for him to come downstairs, and he was never ready on time. And then I realized that I do the exact same thing. So I realized how hypocritical I was being.
Actually, one thing, he doesn't pay attention very much. You know, you can be talking to him, like I could be talking to him like this right now, and then, you know, he'll turn and, what, sorry, were you saying something to me?
Sorry, what's that?
See?
Down in this generation, triumphantly, won't you care to see?
20 years from now, who knows, McMaster and James might be doing their, like, 15th album.
In 20 years, I can see myself sitting on a beach in Mexico. I would definitely like to be performing for a long time, and writing, and production is always something that has interested me.
We produced our earlier demos. That's something that we're really interested in, is producing. We're hoping actually to produce some songs on our next album. Songwriting, performing, I'll be involved in music in some way, I'm sure. Ooh, yeah, yeah. Woo. Just the feedback that we've gotten from our fans already, just about how songs have affected them, and just the way we've connected with certain shows has been a war enough.
Being on stage and singing a song that you wrote and seeing people in the audience mouthing along, you know, that know all the words, it's been reward enough. This has been something that I wanted to do since I was very, very little, and I've always been involved in music.
The luckiest people in the world are people that are just doing what they love to do, and there's nothing else that I would rather be doing.
I wake up in the morning feeling like I'm doing exactly what I want to be doing, and it's a good feeling.
Thank you. Okay, before we do this next song, which is going to be actually our last song of the night, I want to do something that we always seem to forget to do.
Always.
I want to introduce our band. So,
our rock, our foundation, yes. People who we can't do any of this without.
You get a start, Rob.
Over on the right hand side here, it's here to form. It's Brent Parent,
our bass player.
And directly back there, giving us all that rhythm.
I love that noise.
Sweet noise. Dylan Hermiston on drums.
And the rockin' man in the corner over there, the guy playing the electric guitar, that's Mike.
Mike Palance. And I don't know if it's, I guess I'll introduce this guy here. You probably all know who he is anyways. Rob James.
And I suppose, you know, I'll introduce this guy here. You may know him as Luke McMaster.
So I guess there's one song left that we haven't done, and
I'm sure you guys know which one that is. Right? You know what? It's party time. Come on. Right?
Yeah, why don't you guys get up on your seats?
Come up here.
Come up to the stage.
Come up close to the stage.
We want to dedicate this song to all our fans, all you guys that came out tonight. We had a great time, so we want to see you guys grooving and singing along.
Said that day, you said, be careful what you wish for, baby. 'Cause it's a crazy world outside, but you always got a place to hide. Well, you showed me things that I've never seen. You gave me something that I couldn't believe. All the love you give. Just what to say, yeah. I was blind, but now I see. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you.
I want to hear you singing.
Oh, look at Lucas's room. Are you a kid?